clock here. So your test is Thursday and Friday. It is 10 questions. It is worth 75 points total. Bruh is correct. We used to make this a one-day test, but we thought it was evil to make you guys try and finish this whole thing in one day, so we would spread it across 2 days.
Wait, but how long is it?
It's the same length as it's always been. But
I don't...
10 questions? 5 questions a day? Yes?
Oh, it's only 10 questions?
10 questions, but sometimes they have a couple parts, too, like my previous test. Yeah, the nurse thinkers. You definitely want to bring a calculator. On that second day of the test, the last page will just be an MSDS. Okay, you guys remember that? Section 9, all that good stuff. So if you want on that last, second day of the test, you can just rip off that back page when you come in and sort of have it sitting side by side if you would like. All righty, so we're going to go ahead, and the best way to get ready for this test is to do the review sheet I gave you guys tomorrow. Answer key is on your desk at this point, and if it's not, I'll get you a fresh one. It's the pink sheets. Or it's below this video. It's also in the Tuesday and Wednesday folders of Schoology. And to get ready with by doing the thinkers today in class, which we're going to do a whole bunch of. So this little concept map, we're not going to spend much time on this. I just want to remind you guys of a couple of things here. Hey, what's happening at these flat parts? What's happening at flat parts on the graph like this?
A reaction.
What's that?
A reaction.
Phase change. Specifically a phase change. So it must be melting or freezing or boiling or condensing, something like that. Because during a phase change, all the energy going in or out is being used to change the phase itself. Does that make sense? It doesn't change the temperature in any way. It's being used. And that happens at your boiling and melting points. That'd be 0 degrees and 100 degrees if this was a graph for water. Now, other graphs for other substances, they will have this same shape, but they won't necessarily be at 0 and 100 degrees where you have your flat parts. Does that make sense? Okay. So not everything boils at 100 degrees, but whenever something does boil, it will have this flat shape of the graph. Okay, I just want to be really clear about that. 1995, here's your commercial.
Producing Miracle Bond, the incredible new defrosting flavor for food like magic in just minutes. No chemicals, no gas, no wires. Look, this thing could take all day to defrost, but just place it on Miracle Bond, and in 30 minutes, it's butcher block fresh. Amazing.
Anyways, so that commercial is from the early 90s. I was like 4 years old when that came out. You were not even a thought yet. So, the Miracle Thaw, I want you guys to explain to your partner next to you why the Miracle Thaw works. So, for example, if I take some ice cubes, if I put a couple on my block of wood here,
there's an outlet right there.
And if I put a couple on my Miracle Thaw, the couple on my Miracle Thaw melt way faster.
Whoa.
Please take 30 seconds and explain to your partner why the Miracle Thaw works. Use terms from this unit that I'm looking for. Talk to me about highs and lows, all that good stuff. All right, so here's the general idea. A block of wood is a what?
Insulator.
A Miracle Thaw must be a conductor. You got it. What do conductors do with heat? They transfer it rapidly. Okay. Conductors are highways for heat. It doesn't mean they're always hot or always cold. It just means that they transfer heat quickly. When I put ice on the conductor, the ice is the low temperature, the conductor is the high temperature, and so energy from the conductor is flying into the ice. If I were to put my paw on this conductor, will it feel very hot? It just melted ice super quickly. Will it feel hot?
Yeah.
It'll
feel a little warm.
It feels ice cold.
It
feels very, very cold. You know why? I'm the high temperature. This is a low temperature now. And now it's taking heat out of my hand very quickly. Remember? So it sends heat really quickly or it takes heat really quickly, depending on whether it's the high or low temperature. Now, if this was hotter than my hand, this would burn my hand immediately. Okay? This doesn't feel that hot or cold because you know it is taking heat out of my hand right now. This block of wood is doing so very slowly. But yeah, this feels ice cold even though it just melted ice very quickly. So remember, conductors are neither hot nor cold. They just transfer energy quickly. All right, now let's go ahead and talk about our thinker questions. So a new chemistry student's like, how can an object at a lower temperature possess more thermal energy than an object at a higher temperature? Many times people confuse similar terms like heat and temperature. You very well may have been this person a few weeks ago when we started this unit. Describe a situation where one object contains more thermal energy even though it's at a lower temperature. Describe a situation where an object has more thermal energy even though it's at a lower temperature. You have 90 seconds to give me a situation where this could be the case. Oftentimes, numbers can be the most persuasive way to show Mr. Pilcher you know what you know. There are a couple of routes you could take for this one. Here's one idea. Okay. What if you drew something like this and like, all right, say this object has a mass of 1 million grams. And this one's got a mass of 10 grams, okay? You could even start plugging in numbers. We could just make it up. So you'd be like, okay, object A in green, its Q would be equal to 1 million times. I don't know what their heat capacity is, so I'm just going to pretend it's 1 because I don't know what object we're talking about. And let's say its temperature is 2. Why not? Object B, its Q would be 10 grams, mc delta T, times 1, it's the same substance. But let's say its temperature is twice as high. Let's say its temperature is twice as high, and it's 4. This would come out to be 40 joules of energy. This would come out to be 2 billion joules of energy. 2 million. Is that a million? There we go. So there's a perfect example where something at a lower temperature can have way more energy. If its mass is way higher, that'll do it right there. That'll do it right there. Okay? You could also go the heat capacity route. This is the road less traveled. But you could also say something to this effect. You'd be like, well, look, a higher specific heat capacity could also explain this. It takes more energy to raise the temp, so more energy for a smaller temp. In other words, if something has a giant heat capacity, even if its temperature is kind of low, it'll still have a whole bunch of heat energy in it. Does that kind of make sense? Some people don't really vibe with that, what I just said on the right there, so you can just stick with the stuff on the left. But that could be a way you could explain yourself. You could do a little drawing there. You could do a calculation Q equals mc delta T. A lot of people with high success rates bust out Q equals mc delta T to explain themselves all over the place on the test tomorrow. All right, let's talk about another one. Here we got three graphs. We got three graphs, so it's kind of like multiple choice in part. So you took this beaker of water, you blasted it with heat. It started boiling after 20 minutes, and then you finally turned the heat off after 30 minutes. Which one of these graphs shows the temperature of that water over time? So these graphs all go to 30 minutes. Which one of those shows you the temperature of the water over the course of that 30 minutes based on that information above? And tell me if this breaks the law of conservation of energy. You have a minute and 30 seconds to think about this one. Which graph is the one that makes the money? Which one is it? The second one. Really, Glory? How do you know that? Why? What's happening at 100? It's boiling point, right? You can even write the word boil right there. Like, boom, it's going to flatten out, baby. Yep. You're absolutely correct. You're absolutely correct. Now, why doesn't this violate the law of conservation of energy? That's right. It's being used to transfer the water from liquid to a gas. Yep. So the energy is still going into the water. It's not like the energy is like not going anywhere. It just isn't used to change the temperature anymore. It's used to change the state. Only one can happen at a time. So some explanation of that, like, look, the energy isn't like disappearing. It's just being used for something different now. We used it to raise the temperature for the first 20 minutes, and now we're using it to actually boil the water and turn it from liquid to a gas. Something like that, okay? So you can turn this in a bullet point form of like energy used to change temperature for 20 minutes, and then the next bullet point, energy used to boil for 10 minutes. Something like that. Okay? Please, no. Cool. All right, here we go. So let's go ahead. In the experiment titled Heat Exchange Between Metals and Water, so that was the one that used these guys on the strength. It's the very first one we did when we were boiling metals. We compared the heat energy of three different metals. This is the aluminum one I'm holding in my hand. What happens to the amount of energy the metals could transfer? So remember, we boiled these. We tossed them into our double insulator cup of water. How much energy would they be able to transfer if we took this aluminum sample, for example, let's say, and instead of being 30 grams like it is now, we cut it in half and it was only 15 grams. What would that do to the amount of energy that aluminum could send into the water? Please use numbers to explain yourself on this one or talk to me about some sort of equation. 90 seconds. Bye. So, what would happen? What would happen, huh? What would happen if you cut the mass of that metal in half? Think about that. Q equals MC delta T. And yeah, what would happen? I don't know. I wanted to. First person to make eye contact. Who can say? You got an idea? Is it? Okay, Lana, give me something. She regrets raising the hand already. Huh? Why wouldn't it? If math always holds true everywhere. You are absolutely right. That's exactly what happens. So the energy would drastically be cut down basically in half. So that's how you could write it out. Or you could give me something like this. You're like, look, if you cut the mass in half, it's going to cut your Q in half, okay? You can't just cut one side of the equation in half and not the other. Or you could plug it in like this. You'd be like, all right, look, here's your first Q. Let's say your mass is like, you know, 30, and then you have the rest of this stuff. With your next Q, let's call that Q2, if your mass is 15, whatever you're multiplying at the end, it's going to be cut in half. Like, there's just no way to get around it. Your mass, your total Q will be cut in half, that kind of thing. So, yeah, that's exactly what happens. That's exactly what happens. The amount of energy would be cut in half if you cut the mass in half. All righty, not bad. You are a mechanical engineer, and you've been selected. You've been asked to select a new liquid coolant to use an automobile engine. The ideal liquid coolant will remain at a fairly constant temperature as the motor heats up. Would you want this new coolant to possess a high or low specific heat capacity? In other words, I'm basically asking you to explain to me what heat capacity is, okay, and why you'd want a high or why you'd want a low specific heat capacity to keep something's temperature from changing very much. We're just going to do 60 seconds on the clock for this one. Let's see here. Who can tell me whether we want a high or low? Harry!
I said you would want a low because all the energy would travel from the high, which would be like the engine, right? Or
some... Energy would, yeah, the high would be the engine, yeah.
It would travel from the high to the low, heating up the oil so it could work smoothly or something like that.
Okay, all right. Is that what everyone else said? Silent across the way. Well, let's think about this. So, heat capacity, the units on that are joules per gram degrees Celsius. In other words, how many joules do you have to pump into something to change its temperature in degrees Celsius? Okay. Now, what we'll see, and I'll use some numbers to kind of prove my point here, is that you actually want a high specific heat capacity for this particular one. You want a high one because it would take a lot of energy before heating up. And let me elaborate with some numbers, okay? So let's say, for example, and you don't have to write all this down. This is just sort of my example. Let's say substance A has a heat capacity of 10 joules per gram degree Celsius, and substance B has a heat capacity of 1 joule per gram degree Celsius. If I pump 100 joules into substance A, it goes up a degree every time it takes in 10 joules. So it would, in fact, go up 10 degrees. Its delta T would be 10 degrees Celsius. Now, over here, though, the substance B, every time you put a joule in there, okay, the temperature goes up 1 degree. So if I put 100 joules into that guy, its delta T is actually going to be filled T, is actually going to be 100 degrees Celsius. So you guys see how the higher heat capacity will keep the temperature from changing as much. The temperature will not change as much because you need more joules for every degree Celsius. So cars actually, their coolant in car engines is super, has a super high heat capacity. So that way your engine won't heat up too much over time. But it's also one of the easiest ways to kill your engine, take the coolant out. It'll die super quickly because it has nothing to keep it from burning itself up to death, basically. Does this kind of make sense, though? And the numbers, I think, really sort of show the story there. You don't have to use numbers, but I really encourage people to because I think it's the most persuasive way to do it lots of times. All right, now we're here. So why don't people use pot holders? Those are basically like gloves, okay, like the thick gloves that people use when they pull some out of the oven. How come people don't use those when stirring hot foods with wooden spoons? If you're, like, imagine Laura's got just a big pot of chili, okay, and she's stirring with a wooden spoon. She wouldn't need a glove to stir that wooden spoon, but she would, because she would get burned if she used a metal spoon. Please explain this observation. This one I think should be pretty straightforward. Again, use the terms that I'd be looking for in this unit. Make sure you tell me what they mean. 60 seconds. OMG. Okay. So here's how you could write this out with bullet points. If you don't have to have this all written down, but notice what I have highlighted are the key things to get your points along the way. The wooden spoons are insulators. What is an insulator? What does that mean, Mr. P? That means heat transfers slowly. Oh, yeah? Transfers slowly from what to what? From the spoon to your hand. So you have to include all those pieces of information. Metal spoons are conductors. What does that mean? It means they transfer heat quickly from the spoon to your hand. Okay, that's why your hand will get burned, because it's going to send a lot of heat into that poor little paw of yours, oh so very quickly, if you don't have a glove on. Hey, what does that mean those pot holder gloves are anyways?
They're insulators.
They must be insulators, right, to slow down that process. Yep. Now, if you want to go spatial and you want to draw it out for me, here's a beautiful drawing that looks like it's balloons instead of spoons, but I get it, okay. So notice all the things I have here. I got the metal spoon and the wooden spoon labeled. I have the high temps and the low temps labeled throughout. It's clear which ones are spoons and which ones are my paw, even though they're not great drawings. I wrote the word heat to indicate, hey, Mr. P, when I put the arrow, that means heat is traveling, okay? And I wrote the word fast and slow to indicate, hey, this heat's traveling fast. This heat's traveling slow. And the one thing I would add to this student's drawing is I would add some labels, okay, or like conductor, insulator. And I'm just going to put a little arrow so they don't think I'm talking about the paw. They know I'm talking about that wooden spoon. This drawing right here with no other words would be a full credit perfect answer. Okay? So you don't necessarily have to use the bullet point style. I would encourage one of those two strategies, though, heavily on this question. Let's talk about the next one. All right, so you have iron. When it comes in contact with oxygen in the air, it will rust. You guys are all familiar with rust. Okay, you've seen that before. The energy graph for the formation of rust is shown on the left. I'm not going to show mine just yet, but you guys have yours on the left. And it's produced by the following reaction. So we have solid iron mixes with gaseous oxygen from the air and becomes iron oxide. And this is rust. That is your rust right there. That's what rust is. Okay? There are three follow-up questions. They talk about entropy, spontaneity, all that good stuff. Please answer them thoroughly for me. And my hint to you is think about what the universe loves to spread ever since the Big Bang. Think about what the universe loves to spread, what causes things to happen naturally. We have 90 seconds on the clock. Get her cooking. All right, let's talk about it. Now, the first thing that I like to do, whenever I come across one of these little graphs, I like to label them as exiting or entering. Is energy exiting or entering that graph?
Exiting.
You betcha. And that's why I covered it up before, because I don't want to give that away. Because the energy before is a lot higher than it is at the end. So energy must have exited, right? So this must be a what reaction? Exothermic, because energy is exiting. Okay. Food for thought for later. From your experience, is the formation of rust spontaneous? Does rust form on its own.
Yeah.
Yes, it does. And so you can just say, yes, it happens on its own. That's all I'm looking for there. So, Sarah, what you were talking about earlier, this is basically like, what does it mean to be spontaneous? That's kind of that first question. Now, the entropy change. What happened there? Well, entropy depends on your states. So your solids, your gases, your solids again. So this is a huge decrease in entropy because you're going from a gas to a solid. You do not have to use these numbers, but some of you guys might pull out the entropy ranking system. So I see some nods over there. These are from your notes. I think it's Thermochem notes number 3, maybe, from a couple weeks ago. But this is a 2 on the ranking system. That's a solid. Gases are a 35. And this solid, of course, is also a 2. So you're going from a 37 total to a 2. So that's a huge decrease. So if you wrote those numbers on there, like decrease, I'm like, yeah, I get it. We're all good. Now, lastly, it might be surprising that resting is spontaneous when looking at the entropy. Please explain to me why it is a spontaneous reaction. So, hey, since the Big Bang, what are the two things the universe loves to spread? It loves to spread entropy. That means stuff gets further apart. And it loves to spread energy. That is like, you know, sending heat out, okay? So if something is exothermic, it's sending heat out, right? The universe tends to like that. And if something increases entropy, it's spreading stuff out, the universe tends to like that. Okay, so if something's exothermic and increase in entropy, it will be spontaneous. That's just how it works. If it's neither, it won't be spontaneous. If it's spontaneous, it must be at least one of those two things. So this is a decrease in entropy. Does nature like that? No, it does not. So what must it be to cause this to still be spontaneous? Exothermic. And the graph kind of tips you off. Now, I didn't have to give you that graph. You should be able to tell me it must be exothermic based on the fact that it's spontaneous but a decrease in entropy. But I get that there to sort of help you out, kind of guide your thinking. So you can say resting is spontaneous because even though it is a decrease in entropy, it is exothermic. Okay? So some sort of explanation where basically this person's proving to me, Mr. Pilcher, I know the two factors that cause something to be spontaneous. They're exothermic and an increase in entropy. They're showing me that, and they're showing me what this particular situation is an example of. Make sense?
Is
that os? Os?
I spelled os. Is wrong.
I spelled is wrong where?
Even though it's
os. Even though it's os. Oh. Huh. It is. It's always Miss Baseball. Make sure you write that down. Put that on your test. That won't hurt your grade. Okay.
Wait.
Here we go. Here we go. Can I boil water in a paper cup? I'm about to do this right now. Here's a paper cup. Here's some water. I want you guys to just think for 30 seconds if I could do this. Why or why not? 30 seconds. Well, let's see if I can boil water in a paper cup. So I am lighting my Bunsen burner. I have a paper cup with water in it right in front of me. And I'm going to hold over the Bunsen burner for 10 counts. And perfect flame. And here we go. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10. It doesn't burn. It does not burn. Would you look at that? Now, just to prove to you that this isn't some magical cup, I'm going to go ahead and dump out the water that's in there. And I'll give it another 10 count. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10. Well, that cup caught on fire now, didn't it, once the water was out of there? Would anyone care to explain? Glory? They're opposites?
Yeah, like water.
Well, why exactly is that though, Harry?
Because, water is conduct. Maybe it's a conduct. Or, no, it's the low.
We're thinking. Sophia, help him out.
He was like going to the water before, but the water was gone, so it was going to the paper cup or something.
The energy was going into the water before. That's totally true. Instead of the cup, that's true. What is it? What's special about water and energy? What's special about water? Something special about water? It has a really high
density.
heat capacity. Water has a really high heat capacity. In other words, it's really high heat capacity, which is, what is this heat capacity again? 4.18. It can absorb a huge amount of energy without changing the temperature. Water can absorb a huge amount of energy without changing the temperature. So while the heat is scorching the outside of the cup a little bit, so like the bottom of the cup is a little charred before, the water inside is absorbing the energy so the paper won't reach the ignition point. So, hey, what temperature does water always boil at? 100 degrees. If the cup doesn't catch on fire until 233 degrees, could I actually boil water in there?
Yeah.
Oh, yeah. Because it will only go up to 100 degrees as long as water's in there, won't it? Right? So I could boil water in there, no problem. I could boil water in there, no problem at all. Now, what's going to happen the moment all that water's gone, though? It'll burn right away because all the heat energy is, instead of going into boiling the water, it'll go into the cup. It'll reach it. It'll get it to a temperature above 233. It would depend on the picture, but it's very possible that could get you all your credit. I see people who draw pictures only, which is a few labels, and get full credit as long as those pictures are including all the information I'm looking for. Does that make sense? What's that? On this? Yeah, maybe we have a little bit of time towards the end because I want to make sure I get to the other questions real quick, but we can kind of loop back around if we have the time. Alrighty, so here we go. You're performing an experiment. This is probably the toughest math question I could actually ask you. This is probably the toughest math question I could actually ask you. You're performing an experiment in which you heat 30-gram sample of metal by placing it in boiling water for 5 minutes. You then transfer the metal to 60 grams of room temperature water. So 30 grams of metal, 60 grams of water. The final temperature of the metal in the water was 32.5 degrees. What was the specific heat capacity of this metal? This is the Bolt Lab in its entirety right here. So remember the Bolt Lab where we got the heat capacity of that bolt by boiling it, okay? This is that exact lab. If you're a little stuck, maybe get that lab out and take a look at it. But here's a clue I'll give you to start off. Find the Q of that water for me. Find the Q of that water. This is a Q to Q calculation. I'll give you 3 minutes for this one because it's a tough math problem. Now, tomorrow you'd have a little bit more time per question than today. I'm sort of putting you through a gauntlet to get you extra prepared. But I do want to make sure we have time to talk about this as a class. So the Q loss equals the Q gain. Whatever energy, Q that is, that the water gained, that had to come from somewhere, specifically had to come from the bolt. So whatever energy that bolt lost, it went directly into the water. We're going to use that to our advantage. So the Q of the water, I can't calculate the Q of the bolt right now because I don't know the C of the bolt, so I can't get the Q. It's not possible. But I can't get the Q of the water. Now notice, when I get the Q of the water, I use the mass of the water. That's why I'm using 60. I use the C of the water. That's why I'm using 4.18. I use 5.2 because that's the delta T of the water. The water went from 27.3 up to 32.5. That's why I'm using the 5.2. So this is how much energy the water gained. It gained that many joules. Put a little J on there. It gained that many joules. That means that's how many joules the metal lost. The metal lost that many joules. Now we've got a Q for our metal. Now, by the way, the delta T of our metal, it started at 100 degrees, right? Because we boiled it for 5 minutes to guarantee it's at exactly 100 degrees. And then we toss it into that water. It goes down to 32.5, which means the delta T of the metal is 67.5 right here. So Q of the metal is a little over 1,300. The mass of the metal is 30, okay? That's why I use 30 here, not 60. I don't know what the C is, so I just wrote a C. And the delta T of the metal was 67.5, not the 5.2, because the metal went from 100 down to 32.5. So if I solve for my C, you will find that it is, in fact, 0.644 joules per grams degrees Celsius. This could be like at least a 6-point, maybe an 8-point problem tomorrow. This is a tough math problem. This is a tough math problem, okay? But I do expect you all to do this. And if you didn't know how to do the whole thing, if you could get yourself to where you got like the 1,300 joules, getting your Q for water, that gets you something. That gets you a nice chunk of points right there for sure. Even if you couldn't get all the way to the mountaintop. All right. Now I do want to get to our last questions here. Make sure we have time. Last question here on these thinkers. So we have two coffee cups. They are identical in every way. same mug, same coffee, everything. It's just the first mug has twice as much coffee in it. Okay? I want you to tell me, hey, there's a multiple choice question. You don't really ever see those from me, do you? It's only 1 point, but tell me which one of those cups has more heat energy, and then the most of your points here, so this is a 5-point question, 4 of your points would be your explanation in part B. We're just going to do about 60 seconds on the clock for this. Q equals MC delta T is a great way to play on this one. So here's your answer. Cup A, absolutely.
What?
If we have the same temperature and we bring down the mass, it will result in less Q. So in other words, if you're here, Q equals MC delta T, you can make up some numbers. So let's say cup A, the only difference here is its mass is twice as much as cup B's. B is the same heat capacity and the same temperature there. If you plug those in, you'll have twice as much Q on the left as you do on the right. If this was your test tomorrow, and I saw these two numbers pop up with the math, I would know immediately you understand what you're talking about, and that would get you full credit in a heartbeat, okay? In a heartbeat, because math is the most persuasive to me. The reason why I use 4.18 is because coffee is mostly water. If you didn't know it was 4.18, that's okay, as long as you know that since they're both coffee, they should have the same heat capacity no matter what it is. Yeah, and it's mostly water. All right, so tomorrow, you want to make sure you're ready to play. These thinkers are great things to study. Your labs are great things to study. The review sheet is a great thing to study. We did not talk about phase change questions where it's like Q1, Q2, Q3, all that. We didn't do those today. But make sure you can do some of that too, okay? MSDS is section 9, 4.18. Good luck. I'm rooting for you guys.